Inside the Dugout, powered by CubaDugout.com, your resource for discovering Cuban baseball.
Okay. That year I was caught being one of the best. That was on TV. That's on TV. All those plays I did, they got it on the Tele Rebelde or whatever. Okay. And then another one was in Industriales. When Germán Mesa took the Industriales, I was on the team. A week before the National Series, he passed me to Metropolitan. With the team already made, the team it was already made on the new papers and everything, I was in Industriales. He passed me to Metropolitan. That's when I got that great season, my first great season on Metropolitan. He didn't want me. And then I go to the national team on Rotterdam, came back from that preselection I just told you, and my Mesa took me back to Industriales, obligated, because I was the best shortstop, no doubt, of Havana, one of the best in Cuba. So he had to get me on the team.
Yeah, you forced his hand.
Exactly. He didn't want me on the team. He was forced to put me in. That season, I had a lot of trouble with him. Big problems. That kind of like stopped me, my progress as a player. Mm-hmm. He didn't talk about me in a good way on the TV. He never say nothing about me. He never promote me like other players, like he did with other players. I had a bad argument with him, like bad situation. Always against the flow. And then I got that injury. And the last one, it was when I'm on in this last pre-selection I was with Victor Mesa, United States, like a university, like a college team, university, the best talent, went to Cuba, blah, blah, blah. I didn't have a shot. I didn't play. I just went one at bat from the hitting for a catcher. And then I was back to dugout. I didn't play at all. I talked to him, hey, what's going on here? It was a bad argument too. So then I went to another press election that same year. I was doing real good, like real, real good. I was one of the best on the whole press election, talking about every player. He's still struggling. Like they didn't have me and got me on no planes. Yeah, so I'm like, everything I was doing wrong, they was putting big. Everything I was doing good, they didn't mention at all. So I was kind of like frustrated. I said, I can't hold it. That's when I decided to come over here. Not because I just want to come over here and play.
No, and so, I mean, it's fairly well documented in a lot of circumstances, especially for a young player, that if they don't feel that the manager has confidence in them and they're not getting the chance to play, even though they have the belief in their abilities, it's very tough to get into a rhythm, to get into that, like you say, it's you proved yourself when you had the opportunity to get full-time at-bats with the Metropolitanos, that you know you could be one of the top players, but when the manager doesn't have that faith in you, it can be very, very tough. So that's also interesting as well. So would you say that your reason to leave then was more of a baseball decision than say a lifestyle decision, or was it a combination of the two?
No, it was more the baseball decision. Y'all just got tired of the Cuban baseball treating me bad, especially Havana. That was the biggest thing. I blame it to the Havana not government, let's put baseball organization.
Yeah.
I'm blaming to them. They made that happen because they didn't give me the promotion I supposed to have like they did to other players. Because if Havana give me the promotion at the star in my position, I was the best shortstop in that moment in Havana, no doubt. I was showing on the provincial and everywhere I was doing. If they never promote me, always put me they put me like, rocks on my way.
Gotcha. Yeah.
I mean, rocks on my way. It's always struck me.
A lot of roadblocks.
Yeah.
So that's very interesting as well, because, and like I said, looking at some of the players and the increasing number of players that have left, people automatically assume that it's because of the lifestyle in Cuba. And you know, there are some people that definitely do that, or to chase the riches of Major League Baseball, which, you know, at the same time is always a goal. But would you say that your story aligns with many more players that just felt that they were, as you said, there were roadblocks, that would have liked to stay in Cuba if the opportunity that you thought you deserved was presented to you, but had to look elsewhere to continue with your baseball career and do what was best for you?
Yeah, because, for example, when I went to Rotterdam, when Chapman, that's when he defect. Let's put it like that. He just left the team. The rest is his story. And somebody was looking for me too. They supposed to call me to my room. Yeah, I left my room. At 3 o'clock, I left my room. I don't want to talk to anybody. I want to be a Cuban national team player.
Gotcha.
So it wasn't on my mind. I could leave. I was 23 years old. I was on my prime when that happened. I could be a Major League right now if I leave that time.
Yeah.
But it wasn't on my head. I want to be a Cuban national baseball player. That's all. Always was on my head. Play with Industriale, play the national team, be a Cuban celebrity in Cuba.
No, that's very interesting, and that, like I said, that aligns with a lot of, or at least what the mentality used to be, that was the apex, and also why I think a lot of players, even if they do get out and they do have that success, ultimately still love to go back to Cuba when they can. But obviously, it's a very, very complex situation. Talk about your path out, and ultimately, I guess, what led you to Ottawa, Canada, of all places. And when you first kind of came across my radar, playing for the Ottawa Champions of the Can-Am League.
Okay. It was. Well, I started like everybody. I started trying to sign. You know, it didn't happen. I wasn't lucky. It's out there. Still being it could be a yes happen or just a speculation, but I heard a Mets was interested in me. They made an offer to whoever was my agent back then, to my agent, because I did a good tryout with them, real good. I impressed them, but somebody told me that the Mets did the offer. They made that offer. But he was asking for more.
Yeah.
That kind of effect, they back up. They backed out. They backed out. I never know what happened there. What was it? I never knew nothing. Somebody told me. I'm not saying it's for sure, but nobody's going to tell me that for no reason.
How old would you have been at that point?
28.
Okay. And so obviously, being a little bit older can hurt can hurt your market there as well. So it's kind of it's definitely a young man's game, which isn't to say that clearly, you know, you had the talent, but for circumstance could have found yourself in the majors like so many of your countrymen.
But yeah, like it happened to many guys. You got an offer. Sometimes you got to see the guy. Well, how old is him? Oh, okay, 28. You know. $10 million, $8 million is a lot of money still. So the problem was the market, the Cuban market back then was high.
Yeah.
He was signing for $60 million, $40 million. Maybe he got a little greedy. He won $20 million, $25 million. Because it was an interesting story. We was in a house one day, and he came up saying, like it was a blogger saying, yeah, I could cost between $20 to $25 million. Okay, when I looked at blogger, who was the blogger he was talking about, I never heard of
him. No, I promise that wasn't me, so.
Maybe that was his idea to ask for that much money.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? That kind of came to my mind and said, oh, he made that guy who told me, hey, this is happening, maybe he was right.
perhaps that rumor or that perception kind of scared, like you say, either the Mets or teams off, thinking that the price might have been a bit too high. And so this is roughly, as you mentioned, kind of at that age or at that time when we saw a lot of players, so Abreu, Ruzny Castillo, signing for big dollars, which is kind of interesting how we've seen that market seriously change over the past couple of years. And, you know, we just saw Pedro León sign for max of $4 million, which is a relative steal compared to what players were getting in the past. So it's quite interesting to see how that market has changed. Maybe pivoting back to your time here in Ottawa, talk about that experience playing in Canada and whether or not there was some culture shock. Luckily, you were here during the summer, so I don't know if you experienced any of the winter. I hope you didn't, but maybe talk about your experience playing in Canada.
No, let me tell you, I love that country. The time I was there, it was nice. It's so organized. It's clean. People real treat you real good. It's multicultural. It's a lot of different cultures. So that's I love it. I used to go a lot to, you know, with the kind of capital, you know, with the kind of capital of Ottawa.
Yeah, so the Parliament buildings and Wellington Street. Yeah.
Walking around. Yeah. July 1st. Oh, that was big time.
Canada Day, yep.
Yeah, that was big time. I enjoy the day. I love that country. I went to Trois Rivières, like it. I went to Quebec. Beautiful Quebec. Real beautiful Quebec. I went to Winnipeg.
Against the old eyes.
Nice. I got the best experience from Canada. The weather, it was good when I first got there, but the first day, the opening day, it was cold. Like real, real, real cold. My friend was with a Dominican guy. He used to hit with a batting glove, like Vladimir Guerrero or that. He was so cold, he asked me for a batting glove. Hey, he said, hey, Ruby, can you give me some batting glove, man? It's freezing, my hand's freezing. I can't even move I had to give him some extra batting glove I had. He hit that day. It was too cold. Like, I never played that much cold in my life.
Actually, I do remember that game, the opening game for the champions way back in 2015. It was late May, but it was probably close to freezing. So, yeah, it's I can attest to how that was a shock for a Canadian trying to watch a baseball game, little yet for a Cuban trying to play in that game.
As always, subscribe here on YouTube, smash the like button like a hanging slider, or share this video.